to gain the attention and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to praise the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. In my professional life, I'm an executive in the area of marketing. I teach at the Ross School of Business, which is amongst the top 10 business schools in the nation. And I teach strategy consulting, building brand equity, and launching new ventures. And I have my own consulting firm, and I've been doing this, alhamdulillah, for the last 10 years. And I've serviced majority of all of the Muslim organizations, from CARE, ISPU, Sheikh Hamza, Imam Siraj, and through doing these things, alhamdulillah, I have a great relationship with a majority of these key opinion leaders. So I wanted, inshallah, at the end of the 10-year anniversary and when I turned 40, to do something. I asked myself the question, Jameel, what have you done at the end of these 10 years of business for yourself and 40 years of living in this world? And what you come up with is that once the transaction is made between my clients and myself, which happen to be above 700, 97% in the Muslim organizations, they've taken from me what they've taken from me, and I've taken from them what I've taken from them, but what type of impact has that made in humanity? So I was pondering upon this, subhanAllah, and a few days later I had a dream that I would be giving the adhan and that it would be heard around the world. So subhanAllah, we made shura, and with the connections which I have, we were easily able to go ahead and put something like this together. Now, as I'm moving from one place to the other, we'll be doing three things. One is making the adhan. A mu'addin has to do what a mu'addin does. And that is, the hadith of the Rasulullah, that when the adhan is given, everything which is alive and everything which is not alive will bear witness for him on the day of Qiyamah. So I'm trying to make all of you witnesses, inshallah. And the bookshelves and the plants and all of these things. But I can't compete with the mu'addins of Turkey or of Egypt. Mashallah, there are masters out there. But one of the things that a mu'addin can do is to amplify his voice. So again, coming back on the marketing end, with people like this brother right over here and that brother that are taking the videos and the photos, and they put it on Instagram, next to somebody in China is looking at it and they hear the adhan. Somebody from Australia is looking at it and they hear the adhan. This is what it is. The second thing is, why someone asked the khutbatul wada' of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why do that? We have more pressing issues. You're going to go make adhan, you're going to go do this, how is this going to help, right? And subhanAllah, my answer was, what one of my teachers told me. You don't solve complex problems with complex solutions. You don't do that. You solve complex problems with simple solutions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this deen extremely simple. Very easy. The Shaykh said it actually while he was reciting, Ati'u Allah wa Ati'u Rasul, right? It's a matter of obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obeying the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And if we take a look at our situation today, Muslims are facing the biggest calamity of our entire history. We're being demonized, not only here in America, but everywhere around the world. It's a double standard, right? And we don't know how to react. We don't know what to do. We don't know what to say to defend ourselves. So when we don't know what to do, we look for a guiding light. And the guiding light is here, in my laptop, in my keynote presentation. The most eloquent speech ever delivered in the history of humanity was the Khutbatul Wida' that was delivered to the Sahaba Ajma'een during the only Hajj that the Prophet ﷺ made. And the amazing part of this speech is that it is hardly 3 to 5 minutes. Hardly 3 to 5 minutes, and a summary of a perfect mission. 23 years worth of a perfect life summarized in one speech. And it will say in here, and I'll relate this with you, it's not optional, it's a command that he gave to the Sahaba Ajma'in radiallahu ta'ala anhu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them. That those who are here shall take these words to others, and others shall take these words to others again, and may the last ones understand these words better than the ones who hear it from me directly. That means that you and I have an incumbent responsibility to take these words to our family members, and to our friends, and to our community, and to our neighbors, and to our co-workers. But somehow, some way, this speech has been covered with layers of dust. And now we have our own leaders. A lot of them are my friends, the mashayikh, the academic scholars, the politicians, who are trying to use their own words. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them, but they are dwarfed in the shadow of the words of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what I intend to do, very simply, is to remove these layers and to take the foundation and to raise it high, inshallah, so that everybody gets a direct link to these words, to this nasiha, you know, to this advice that was given from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I begin with my words. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما On the night of Dhul Hijjah, in the 10th year of Hijrah, in the Urana Valley of Mount Arafah, after praising and thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O people, lend me an attentive ear, for I know not whether after this year I shall ever be amongst you again. Therefore, listen to what I am saying to you very carefully, and take these words to those who could not be present here today. O people, just as you regard this month, this day, this city is sacred. So regard the life and property of every Muslim as a sacred trust. Return the goods entrusted to you to their rightful owners. Hurt no one, so that no one may hurt you. Remember that you will indeed meet your Lord and that He will indeed reckon your deeds. Allah has forbidden to you to take usury. Therefore, all interest obligations shall henceforth be waived. Your capital, however, is yours to keep. You will neither inflict nor suffer any inequity. Allah has judged that there should be no interest, and that all interest due to Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib shall henceforth be waived. Beware of Shaytan for the safety of your religion. He has lost all hope that he will ever be able to lead you astray in big things. So beware of following him in small things. O people, it is true that you have certain rights with regards to your women, but they also have rights over you. Remember that you have taken them as your wives only under Allah's trust and with His permission. If they abide by your right, then to them belongs the right to be fed and clothed in kindness. Do treat your women well and be kind to them, for they are your partners and committed helpers. And it is your right that they do not make friends with anyone whom you disapprove, as well as to never be unchaste. O people, listen to me in earnest. Worship Allah. Say your five daily prayers. Fast in the month of Ramadan. Give your wealth in zakat and perform hajj if you can afford to do so. All mankind is from Adam and Eve. An Arab has no superiority over a non-Arab, nor a non-Arab has no superiority over an Arab. Also, a white has no superiority over a black, nor a black has any superiority over a white, except by piety and in good action. Learn that every Muslim is a brother to every other Muslim, and that all Muslims constitute one brotherhood. Nothing shall be legitimate to a Muslim which belongs to a fellow Muslim, unless it was given freely and willingly. Do not therefore do injustice to yourselves. Remember, one day you will appear before Allah and answer for your deeds, so beware. Do not stray from the path of righteousness after I am gone. O people, no prophet or apostle will come after me, and no new faith shall be born. Reason well, therefore, O people, and understand the words which I convey to you. I leave behind me two things, the Quran and my example, the Sunnah. And if you follow these, you will never go astray. All those who listen to me shall pass on my words to others, and those to others again. And may the last ones understand my words better than those who listen to me directly. Be my witness, O Allah, that I have conveyed your message to your people. And I maintain what I say now for the 11th time in the 11th community in the 11th state, that you here in this masjid are the lucky ones. And it was predestined and it's other that I was coming to this masjid out of all the different masajids that I could have come to in the state of Alabama. And you were here to listen to these words. And subhanAllah, out of all the different things that I do when I come to the masjid, I see that the attention is like 100% from the children, from the elders, from the students, from the sisters. You know, subhanAllah, there's blessing, there's barakah in these words. There is a hidden treasure within these words, if you can call it. In this day and age, when people ask us, well, what do you have to say about ISIS? What do you have to say about how you treat your women? SubhanAllah, you can respond with this khutbah. You can say, we've been told not to hurt anyone so that no one will hurt us. It's right here. It cannot be misconstrued. We've been told to treat our women properly because they are a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With His permission, our committed partners and our committed helpers. In this 3-minute khutbah, we have gender equity, we have racial equality, we have fairness, we have peace, we have direction. Our compass is pointing the right way. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was perfect and he was guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he left this for us. This is the legacy. This is the legacy that we have to follow. And someone asked, well, is this the solution? Yes, of course it's the solution. Of course it's the solution. And we don't need to get, you know, very advanced. We don't need to modernize. We don't have to customize things for today's time. Some things are golden, and this is one of them. With regards to my project, as I mentioned to you, you know, I intend to, inshallah, give the adhan, you know, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us as sincere as possible. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to serve you all, the community, our brothers, in the best way that we possibly can. I'm actually in the khidmah even of my late father. You know, my father was a professor at the University of Michigan in the area of microbiology, and he also had his ijazah in all of the different styles of qurra. He was a qurra, he was a qadi. You know, and he went to Ramadan one day, he was 63 years old, to an iftar party, you know, one of my uncles. And it was away from his masjid. And subhanAllah, you know, it was too late. We told him, you know, Taraweeh is not fard on you. It's, you can do it and make qiyam at home. Or just stay in the basement. It's a big house, doctor's house. You know, you have plenty of room. And we all put pressure on him not to go to the masjid, you know. And so he listened, you know, at the end of the day. But he went upstairs. He was dismayed. You know, and all the children were playing upstairs and somebody turned on the television. And when they turned on the television, guess what was on the screen? Masjid al-Haram, right? With Taraweeh going on and people making tawaf. He didn't tell anybody, he didn't ask anybody. He found a ride to the masjid and was there. And subhanAllah, I got a phone call a little while later, said that you need to come to the masjid. You know, something's happened to your father. When I went on the scene, you know, subhanAllah, he was surrounded by doctors to his right, to his left, to his front, to his back. And they said that your father prayed Salat Isha. Then he prayed Salat Sunnah. And then he went into his second rak'ah. He went into the second sajda and he passed away. SubhanAllah. Right? Very bitter and very sweet at the same time. You know, at the same time.
All sweet.
I mean, this is the reason why, you know, to be able to be with wudu in the masjid during the month of Ramadan, praying sunnah, saying subhanahu rabbil ala and having your soul collected. You know, this is what, of course, I would like to have, and I would like to have for my children, you know, as well. My son, he is studying to be a hafiz of Quran, he has 19 juz, you know, underneath him. So, you know, in the early hours of the day before Fajr comes, you know, people, you know, we are trained as executives. You know, we tell people that you want to get an early start. That's what we say to our CEOs and CFOs when people like us, you know, we tell them. And also that is the habit of the Salihin, right? That they get up early in the morning and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I was remembering, I said, okay, my father got what he got. My son is going to have more than me. What am I going to do? What skills, what gifts do I have? And I said that this faqir is a mu'adhdhin, right? And so I decided to go ahead millimeter by millimeter, inshallah, trying to gain the attention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the same time, you know, this is a wonderful mercy by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that even though your father has passed away, you have an opportunity to do something, to do right by him, right? To be able to do some sadaqah jariyah. You try to be one of the salih, right? So every year I go for Umrah at least once a year. Since 2004, we make 10 days itikaf, we give sadaqah, even my own children, these type of things. But the reality of the matter is that as a mu'adhdhin, you know, I wrote an article recently for the most influential Muslim blog in the United States, Muslim Matters, called The Essential Mu'adhdhin. And as I was writing that article, you know, what is the focus point? What is the main message? The main message from a mu'adhdhin is to establish the adhan in your household. Is to establish the adhan in your household. Because if you do not make the adhan in the household, there will be no response to the adhan, and you have compromised jama'ah and salah. And salah is the focal point. Salah is the focal point. If you take a look right now, what is the most important thing? When a person passes away, are they going to ask you first, how much sunnah did you implement? How much zakat did you give? How much Quran did you memorize? How much dawah did you do? How many degrees do you have? How many records did you set? Is that what they're going to ask? They're going to ask you, first and foremost, your prayer. That is the relevance of this particular act. And so we find that when we say this, that we have to establish the adhan in the household, a lot of fathers at the beginning, they said, oh, I need my son to hear this. And I said, no, you got it twisted. You don't need the son to hear this. The son is not the khalifa of the household. The son is not the amir of the household. The son is not the leader of the household. The son is a subordinate at this particular stage. It's our responsibility to set the example. This is, giving the adhan is public speaking. How many people would just get up and give a speech like this? I was very, very shy. I started giving the adhan when I was 11 years old. But I didn't want to come in front of the mic. You know, they need to see an example. They need to be encouraged. Confidence needs to be given. If that happens, inshallah, they will follow that example. If not today, then tomorrow. If not tomorrow, later on in life. The blueprint will be there, inshallah. But when the adhan is given,